You can see it, and then when you are ready, you just let us know.
Yes.
No hurry. The next speaker, Nilesh, the next speaker.
The next speaker is Chandrasekhar Devapujari, sir. We must ask him if he is ready with his presentation. Devapujari, sir, can you hear me?
Dr. Devapujari, are you there?
Sir, he has logged in, but his mic is.
There he is. Okay.
Yeah, here he is.
So, can you see my screen?
Yes.
I need to get some. I need to change my view because I'm not able to see my slide properly. Okay. I'm good now. So if I can start, I think there were two or three lectures happening before mine, and but I think Abhida has given a very good anatomy talk and about the gravity of the problem and the changing epidemiology. So we'll get to a less talked about problem, and which probably doesn't endanger the patient immediately, and it's not therefore much talked about, and look at a little bit of epidemiology and what is the current status of imaging, various other diagnostic methods and management. So basically, I think we all know that India is unfortunately head injury capital of the world, and we seem to get quite a lot of CSF leaks. How they are managed, we do not have any comprehensive data, but the fact remains that it is a big problem, and we do see from time to time that patients reach a very bad state with their CSF leaks and resultant meningitis. So basically, for a CSF leak to occur, you need to have a breach or dehiscence in all the layers, including arachnoid, dura, and the bone. And most commonly, it occurs due to road traffic accidents, but it can also occur due to simple falls. And one of the main indications that is emerging is the our surgeries. I think a lot of skull-based surgeries have resulted into defects, but we are not going to discuss that today. The fact that there could be CSF leak following cranial trauma was known as back as second century. And in fact, this was related in 1795 to basal skull fractures by one of the Dutch surgeons. And radiological confirmation, mainly in the form of pneumocephalus, was seen in 1913. And the fact that CSF leaks are synonymous with the aerosol was also demonstrated at that time, and Dandy, like many other things, was performed the first successful closure. Thereafter, there has been a rapid progress. Keynes classified CSF rhinorrhea, talked about extradural approach. Schroeder talked about resolution of leak with lumbar drains, which some people still practice today. Dolman first talked about extracranial repair. A first endoscopic repair was talked about by Wigand in 1981. Most common post-traumatic CSF leaks occur either through sphenoid, ethmoid, or cribriform. And 80% of leaks come from trauma, and about 16% from surgical procedures. This is the statistics of, I think, 2002. And out of the traumatic leaks, about 50% are evident in the first 2 days, 70% almost in the first week, and rest of them are present in first 3 months. Very rarely you have reports that it could have happened as late as about a year. And the classification by Omai and McCoy between spontaneous and traumatic. So the spontaneous variety was described by them. And then we have been talking about management of these lesions. And basically, you have to differentiate between the two. because there is no conservative management for non-traumatic CSF rhinorrhea, while in traumatic CSF rhinorrhea, there are certain indications where you could treat them conservatively. The sites of CSF leak could either be one of the paranasal sinuses when it communicates with the dura. It could be most likely in the anterior cranial fossa, very rarely in the middle cranial fossa, and very, very rarely the posterior petrosal leaks, but it's more common in post-traumatic, post-surgical leaks. These are some of the statistics very early on, which showed the various sites of leak, which confirmed virtually the same. There is also a classification between the anterior cranial fossa fracture, and what is understood is that more midline the fracture, the more chances of leak and meningitis, and multiple defects are not uncommon. Diagnosis is not easy. In the very beginning, it is fairly easy, but in a late stage or in when the patient does not remember the trauma, if it has been after a trivial trauma, it is very, very difficult to differentiate. And therefore, you have to look for certain things like the salty test, if the patient complains about the relationship with the position, etc. And in acute cases, you have to look about for the associated periorbital edema, if there is optic nerve damage, etc. Some of the tests which have been described well as confirmatory is the handkerchief test, the typical target sign, the glucose oxidized test, if you have more than 20 milligrams per deciliter. And beta transferrin is the highly sensitive and specific method, but it is expensive, not available everywhere, and therefore should be probably reserved in cases where there is confusion. And the percentage of glucose and chlorine concentrate has also been used by people as one of the reliable indicators. There is this paper which talks about the specificity. I think it is very good. However, though it is difficult to get, and therefore if you have a good imaging and a definite history, I do not think you need to subject every patient to beta 2 transferrin. Classification according to the timing of CSF leak, you can get an early leak within the first week, delayed leak after a week or so, and very delayed, that is months and years of injury, and your management also depends on that. In early leak, you'll probably manage the patient primarily for the brain injury, and if it is profuse, you'd probably tell the patient to be in bed, and the diagnosis is easy in such cases. And bed rest, reduction of ICP, and avoiding all strenuous straining maneuvers is what you usually prescribe to the patient. And the main worry remains is the prevention of meningitis. So meningitis seems to be the main reason why CSF leaks need to be looked at very, very carefully. And one of the early series from Glasgow showed that in a series of 155 patients, early exploration did not decrease the rate of meningitis or morbidity. This is a later paper by Ajamel in 1990, which shows that it has probably helped by giving antibiotics to delay the surgery a little bit, but not a very convincing evidence there. In fact, we all know that traumatic CSF fistula adds on to the already complicated issues in the management of traumatic head injury and its prognosis. And the various studies, large number of studies from United States, over 382,000 routine admissions for about 4 years were studied. Closed skull base fractures in almost 20,000, open skull base fracture in 5,000. And you had almost 453 patients with CSF leaks, and almost 7.7% of them developed meningitis, while in otorrhea, the percentage was much less in terms of development of meningitis. And they concluded that this is an independent predictor for recovery and morbidity of the patient. A recent study in 2016 in China has also shown that the rate of morbidity due to CSF leaks increases from 3.8% to 9% if you have a CSF leak in the patients. Should prophylactic antibiotics be used? I think this has been very heavily discussed in almost all meetings amongst many surgeons. And though the earlier studies have shown some benefit of prophylactic antibiotics, all the studies after the year 2000, including the Cochrane database, has not really shown any advantage of prophylactic antibiotics in these patients. You can read up about it in the recent health bulletin which has come out. And one of the most important thing that seems to be emerging is the fact that you can actually get into a more serious or resistant kind of meningitis. One thing which should probably be given is the anti-pneumococcal vaccine, but it is still not a common, but I think most of us are now using it in our patients while waiting for surgery. On acetazolamide, again, there are several beliefs, but a study undertaken by in a large number of patients at PGI Chandigarh has actually shown that it did not influence the resolution of traumatic CSF rhinorrhea. Lumbar drain insertion initial paper in 2008 had actually shown that there was a definite benefit. However, another paper in this decade has shown that it has neither reduced or resolved CSF leaks before surgery. And in fact, even after surgery, keeping a drain has not helped very much. And uniform policy nowadays is if at all you need it, it will be used for a very, very short time. So basically, the conservative approach consists of bed rest, laxatives, and intermittent or continuous lumbar drainage, depending on the belief of the unit. We do not do a lumbar drainage unless the patient has been repaired. And then imaging is important, not only to confirm the leak, but identify the cause, aid in localizing where it is, and assessing the size of the defect. This can be done on X-ray, simple X-ray skull. If you see a pneumocephalus and you know where the fracture is, maybe you can treat it. Radioisotope cystinography was the mainstay before the CT era, but mostly nowadays we are dependent on HRCT, MR cystinography, and CT cystinography in case the leak is persistent and if there are no other signs of raised intracranial pressure. Our own protocol is to use combined high resolution computed tomography with MR cystinography, which are images are superimposed. And this technique was evaluated by some of our colleagues in Mumbai and published in AJNR in 1998, and very, very reliable technique with almost 96% reliability. When you do not have a definite site of leak, the fluorescein can help you during the diagnostic endoscopy, and you can probably proceed even with repair if you're otherwise prepared for it. In management, I think you have a low threshold of surgery if the fracture is close to the midline, if the bony defect is more than 1 centimeter, if there is a bony spicule or a fragment in between, and if there has been a recurrent or persistent CSF leak and evidence of meningitis. So basically the central issue in consideration of surgical intervention is the risk of meningitis in attempting conservative therapy related to the operative morbidity associated with repair of a particular leak. And you will definitely consider surgery when the traumatic leak is failing the conservative management, if there has been an episode of active meningitis, or if you are definitely seeing a pneumocephalus. Timing of surgery is also a matter of discussion. Though nobody operates immediately in the first 1 or 2 days, but if there is no signs of raised ICP, if the patient is otherwise stable, the surgery is usually performed towards the end of second week. Early surgery is especially indicated in penetrating injuries, anterior fossa surgery when you have other complicating matters, like you have a hemorrhage which needs to be drained, or if you have compound facial fractures for which the patient has to go to surgery, if you have an associated optic nerve injury, if there is a large aeroseal, if there is a brain herniation seen already, if there is a widely comminuted fracture, or if there is a soft tissue wedged in between the fracture limits. One of the papers in a journal of skull base has actually shown that most of the cribriform leaks can be waited upon for the first 2 weeks, as almost 80% of them close, while the posterior wall of the frontal sinus leaks do not usually close and should be more closely observed for surgery. Delayed surgery may be required in patients who have failed conservative treatment beyond 10 days. Recurrent leak has occurred after the initial stoppage, or if there is a meningitis or abscess at any given time. The procedure is either intracranial, intradural, extracranial, which is usually the endoscopic endonasal nowadays. Intracranial approach can either be extradural or intradural. And you may need to shunt very, very rarely. The main debate today is actually endonasal endoscopic versus transcranial approach. So basically, the extracranial approaches were described way back in 1990 with the idea that you do not want to get intracranially in these acutely injured patients and reduce your morbidity. And it has shown a reasonable kind of a success rate. And then while analyzing the different surgical approaches, it was very, very clearly observed that simple leaks can be repaired by endonasal approach, and only for complicated leaks, large bone defects, you should be using the intracranial approach. So in endoscopic, I think the principles are you identify the leak, you expose and delineate the defect, create a raw area surrounding the defect, plug the defect with the fat, cover it with a fascia. Tissue glue is normally used in most centers today. And then you support your repair with either gel foam or Merocel, and you may use CSF drainage depending on your level of comfort in terms of closure as well as management of your drain postoperatively. And the four basic approaches are you go for the medial cribriform, where you don't have to do too much bone work except for maybe lateralizing the turbinates a little bit, a transethmoidal for a lateral wall of sphenoid, you need to do a transmaxillary, transpterygoid kind of approach. And for posterior fossa, you need to do transmaxillary, much more complex approaches. And most of the material used are either fat or muscle. Fat is preferred by most people. If you are using a free repair, fascia lata is the most commonly used flap. In pedicle flaps, either you can use the turbinate as a flap, or you can use a nasoseptal flap, which has become more popular nowadays. And most of these are settled in place by fibrin glue. Dural substitutes may be used as one of the layers, but cannot be used as the main component of your repair. And I think there are various ways the repairs are done, but the most common is a multi-layer repair. And you use some kind of a sandwich repair, as we just talked, fat, fascia, glue, and then maybe a flap on top of that. May not be for every patient, but for a more complex kind of a approach. And most important thing is you need to make the area properly raw so that your repair fits in properly. This is one of the medial cribriform repairs. You can see the defect here, lateral cribriform. And you start seeing the small encephalocele here. The area around it is being made raw and seems to have reasonably healed, but obviously you can see some CSF leak when you start pushing it. And then a free fascia has been used. And here we have not used any flap. It has been stuck by glue only at the edges. You do not interpose the glue between the fascia and the fat. This is a medial cribriform. Here again, you need to create a proper raw area. You need to make sure that all the gliotic material has been taken care of. And then the fascia has been used to cover it completely. This is another which is almost going up to the back wall of the frontal sinus. These are debatable. Should you be doing transcranial or transnasal? This patient insisted and gave us a chance, and we could repair it fully. That's the mucosa being taken out with part of encephalocele, defect being identified completely, then being plugged with fat, and then a free repair has been done. This is a lateral sphenoid leak. This is very difficult to repair transcranially, so it is best repaired by a transpterygoid kind of approach. I don't think I will take you through the video. We don't have so much time. And nasoseptal flap is the most common flap based on the nasopalatine artery today. Recent review of literature shows you that this probably suffices almost 90% of the patients where you can do this kind of a repair. And mucoperiosteal flaps are available either from turbinates or from the nasoseptal area. And therefore, a need for transcranial surgery is becoming less and less. And the other obvious advantage is it is more appealing to the patients because of it is cosmetic and there is in fact, a very good visualization if you are used to using an endoscopic technique. The disadvantage, which is quoted most often by many of our colleagues, is that it is unphysiological. You never repair a break from below, but the proof of the pudding is in eating. And I think we know that it heals well and it works well for almost close to 85 to 90% of our patients. And therefore, the main problem comes is in a non-active leak where you cannot locate a definite kind of, and you cannot just put a carpet of fascia in if you are going transnasal. One of the biggest series which has changed outlook for most of us, especially in Mumbai and I think most of India, is a large series of over 250 patients by Dr. Kirtane, one of our colleagues at the KEM hospital, who have shown 96% success rate in the first instance, and it has been improved to 98.8% on second attempt at repair. And I think that has stuck with most of us, and it has given good success rate in many of our colleagues' hands, as you will see in a moment. A meta-analysis by Karaus-Schneiderman group in 2000 has also shown in 289 CSF fistula that their success rate was also 97%. And Yadram Yadav and some of our colleagues in India have again shown a large series where there is a close to 90% plus success rate. So basically, when we are talking about what to use, etc., people have studied different modalities of treatment, different ways how you pack the cavity, how you put the graft, and almost everything seems to work in hands of different people. And there has not been a definite kind of a recommendation which can be made based on this. Transcranial repair is usually required when you have pneumocephalus, large pneumocephalus, if you have evidence of increased intracranial pressure, if there are other neurological symptoms, if you see that the patient requires surgery intracranially anyway for either removal of a clot or for any other reason. Most of us will do a bifrontal craniotomy to do this. And this is an extra dural kind of repair, back of the frontal wall. And back of the frontal wall can be repaired by extra dural, but anything behind that is difficult to repair. Again, I won't take you through the pictures. For the posterior repairs, you must take a very good galliopericranial flap. And this can give you a very good closure right up to the anterior clinoid. And certainly it helps to have some glue ready. The most important consideration is a multi-layered graft reconstruction, because one layer, second layer, third layer, you will have all the three layers in such a configuration that you are unlikely to fail, like the typical example given of holes in the cheese slices, and they will not come at the same place. And using vascularized tissue flaps has certainly made it easy, especially for more complex repair. People are also talking about using bone now. Cadaveric bone is not favored. And there is vascularized rotational temporal bone flap and many other flaps which have been used. You are going to have a very nice lecture by Dr. Goyal, who published some of his experience in 2000. And I have been guilty of not quoting it earlier, but I think he is going to tell you about it very soon himself. And there are other people who have written about using split thickness graft with temporalis muscle to cover these defects. In complications, I think the most common complication is formation of a mucocele, and therefore you need to excentrate and cranialize the sinuses very well. Like everywhere else, the minimally invasive approaches has also entered the transcranial corridor. And this is a paper by one of our colleagues Dr. Sinha, who does it in Delhi with endoscopic transcranial kind of a pterional small craniotomy and repairing defects intracranially. And Castelnuovo and some of the other European surgeons have developed transorbital approaches, which seem to be very, very well, very promising. In very rare cases, we have had to do it only in malignancies of the cranial base, that you need to use flaps. And this is one of the radial artery flaps which has been used in this particular patient. I'll just take one more minute for CSF otorrhea. Fortunately, less common. It is mainly associated with longitudinal fractures. And what is more important is that most of them close very well. The most important thing to remember is sometimes they can present as paradoxical CSF rhinorrhea, like what happened in this 7-year-old boy. He had a small kind of a defect in the cribriform, which was repaired at another place. And when he came to us with meningitis, we also first explored that. And when we saw that the CSF was actually coming from the inferior part, we realized that it was coming from the ear, and the CSF cystinography showed the defect in the ear. And then this was repaired by a transmastoid approach. Fibrin sealants have certainly helped in strengthening our repairs, especially putting our flaps in place for a fairly long time. And I think to sum up, I would just like to say that literature does not support routine use of prophylactic antibiotics, lumbar drainage. Almost all kind of endoscopic repair have had similar success rate, and most of the defects which are below less than 1.5 centimeters and leave frontal sinus apart, I think most of the defects can be closed by endoscopic approach. Postoperatively, bed rest or not has also become controversial now. Many people are preferring that we mobilize the patient early, but we usually keep them in bed for about 24 hours, get them mobilized in bed for the next 2 days, and get them out of bed by third day. Need for a shunt is extremely, extremely low. We have had to do only 2 patients after they have failed transcranial as well as transnasal repair. One of them was a malignancy. One of them was a sphenoidal encephalocele. And in most other patients, we've had about 270 patients by now where it has been successful. Almost 54 patients have had transcranial repairs. About 220 patients had endoscopic repair. So last word I would say is that what is most important in deciding a surgical approach is not only the lesion and the patient, the preferences, the expertise of the surgical team. And I think a good teamwork is required even for a proper management of CSF rhinorrhea. Thanks, Saib, for the opportunity.
Thank you.